Welcome to Words of Aloha with Pastor Isy Manzo of Amazing Grace Ministries International. We're headquartered in Kailua, Kona on the Big Island of Hawaii. Join us now as we get into God's Word.
Lord, we thank you for this Christmas Sunday, Lord, that we can gather together and celebrate the greatest gift ever given to mankind, your Son. Lord, we ask you now to use Pastor Isy to speak to each one of us. Lord, touch our hearts, our minds, our soul. Give us strength, Lord, for this coming week. We ask that now in Jesus' name. And all God's people said,
Amen. Amen. Well, guys, if you'd grab your Bibles and turn to the Gospel of Luke this morning. I told you to read Matthew 1 and 2 in your bulletin for this week, and that was to give you a little background for the birth of our Lord as we get to celebrate on this fine Christmas morn. And I don't know about any of you, did any of you grow up in a Christian household where you had a traditional, like go to a traditional service maybe on Christmas Eve? Or who had to get up and get dressed and polish your shoes and clean? I mean, I know it sounds funny. The kids today are like, what? Polish shoes? What is that? You know, slippers and go to church. You know, it's just, it's nothing like that. But I grew up in a Catholic upbringing, so we had to, Christmas and Easter, I don't care how bad a Catholic you are, you at least go twice a year. And so Sunday on Christmas was, and if it ever fell like today, falling on Christmas morning, boy, was that a super Sunday, you know? And so you had the ooh factor, but it also somehow made more stress. Like you had to get dressed better, you had to like be super head to toe, every hair is like perfect and get all ready, make your shirt all nice, you know, put the tie. I am so grateful to serve the Lord in Hawaii. We don't have to do the tie thing. We get to be casual, toes in the sand, you know, enjoy the beach and maybe have some whales pop up while we're worshiping the Lord and seeking Him. It lets me focus more on what the message is really about. And so today, I want to do something with you. Now, this comes from a little bit of a tradition that I learned when I married my wife. Well, actually, before I married her, we dated 4.5 years. And she was brought up in a Lutheran upbringing. And her folks, on Christmas morning, they would let them open a present, I think, one on Christmas Eve, but not the rest of the presents till Christmas morning. And before they could open the presents on Christmas morning, they had to read Luke chapter 2. You know, they had to sit, and some of you had to do this. This is the part what tells the birth of the Lord. Okay, and that was before that they would do any of that. Now, I was, you know, being raised Catholic, we weren't really told to read the Bible ourselves. We were told that's the priest's job or the nun, and they would tell us what it would say, you know, but we didn't really have to read, except I had a rebel for a grandmother. She was from Sicily, and she would always read me the Bible in Italian when I was growing up. So even though it was for the priest or the nun, I guess because she was an elder, you know, they can get away with stuff that the young ones couldn't. So, well, I mean, we had a Bible. I don't know if you guys ever seen a Catholic family Bible. They're like these fancy, fancy bound books with like white leather embossed and everything. It has the inside, the names of everyone who's been baptized and when you were christened, everything all put in there. And the funny thing was we were never allowed to touch the thing. It was on the, you know, like display in the house, but it wasn't to read, it was just to record who got married when, who was born when, who died when. You know, it had like a little section like this in the front, you know, you put all the info in, and that's all it was. And we didn't really get stories except what we were told. And I was so grateful for my grandmother because she would read me the stories. And you know, when you hear the stories as a child, it's amazing. In the mind of a child, the things you think of, you know, the way that your mind's thinking in your younger years, you're trying to figure out the story. Mary is a virgin, but she has a baby. And what does that mean? You know, you don't understand any of that. So it just kind of goes right over your head. And it doesn't really mean that much, but that Mary had a baby. And Mary, in Italian, her name is Marie. That's what it would be called. My sisters, by the way, Christina Marie, Ursula Marie. My daughter Raquel Marie. So it's an Italian thing. You gotta name the middle name at least after Mary. Now, this is from, the reason they do that is because of Mary in the Bible. She's very revered in the Catholic upbringing. And today, in Luke's Gospel, the part right before what most people already know, you know, the beginning of Luke 2 where it announces that Mary and Joseph, there was a census going to be taken. They were going to have to go to their hometown and register for the census, and Mary is going to be with child by the Holy Ghost. Before that, there's a story about Jesus' cousin, John the Baptist. And I don't know if you guys know this story, but there's a tie between the two births. They're very close together. You guys know which one was born first? John? That's right, John. He's 6 months older than Jesus, John the Baptist, his cousin. And the reason I want to back up to chapter 1 of Luke, if you would with me, just a little bit into the chapter, we're going to read the part what the angel Gabriel visits. First he visits the family of the parents of John the Baptist, and then he's going to go visit Mary. And it's kind of cool because, I don't know about you, but has anyone here ever wished, like, your faith, it would help you? God, if you're really there, could you show yourself? Or if you're really there, could you send me an angel just to, like, talk to me? Or, you know, you ever wondered about, first of all the guys would see angels in the Bible, what's the first thing angels usually say?
Don't be afraid.
So for those of you hankering for an angelic visit, let me tell you, just get ready to not, you know, wet your britches, because as soon as a real angel shows up, you know, some people say, I saw an angel and it was like little cute pastel-y, looked like one of those precious moments. I said, you didn't see a real angel. I said, why do you say that? I said, because can you imagine a little pastel 2-inch thing going, don't be afraid. I go, I'm not. But if a real angel shows up, a real one, I mean, in their majesty, the first thing that the angel has to tell the people is, fear not, or do not be afraid. Why? Because just the presence of an angelic being manifest to us would just be like, you know, whoa, we'd be afraid. And let me show you, in this scripture, I find it really interesting, the angel Gabriel. We're going to read about him here. Let me just show you. In Luke chapter 1, if you would turn there, starting in I'm going to start in verse 5 this morning. Now, this morning's study is not going to be real in-depth. It's more going to be familiarizing you with the book. You know, if you didn't get to read it when you were younger, let me read it to you. And may it just sink in, just to hear the words, what the scripture says about these times when Jesus was about to visit this earth. I mean, it is a valid point. People ask me all the time, if God is real, why doesn't he show himself? Why didn't he come down here and show that he's really real to man? Surely God could do that, couldn't he? If he's God, he can make everything. Can't he just show himself? And the answer is, he already did. And here's the accounting that we have of it right in the scriptures. Now, it's also found in Matthew 1 and 2. But today I'm going to focus just on Luke 1 and 2. Starting in verse 5, we read this morning. It says, in the days of Herod, king of Judea, there was a priest named Zacharias. Now, he was of the division of Abijah, and it says, and he had a wife from the daughters of Aaron, and her name was Elizabeth. We have an Elizabeth right here with us, see? So, okay, there we go. Visual aid. And so it says, they were both righteous in the sight of God. They walked blamelessly in the commandments and the requirements of the Lord. But they had no child because Elizabeth was barren. And it says, well, we can't use you anymore because it says they're both advanced in age. And it happened that while Zacharias, you're not advanced enough for this, right? That means they're old, okay? Just, there's your Bible commentary. They're old. And it happens that he is performing the priestly service before God. Now, you say, how old in the Jewish culture you're allowed to do priestly duties of setting up the tabernacle, tearing it down? This is all stuff from the Levitical law. It's boring to read, but I'll just give you the summed up version, okay? You can do all the heavy lifting until you're 50. You can carry, you know, articles of the tabernacle in, help set up the tent, all that stuff. But after 50, you're supposed to not retire. You're supposed to take the next 15 years to be like a mentor, where you pass on how to do the work of the priestly duties to the younger guys. So for the next 15 years till you're 65, you don't do the heavy lifting, but you do, you participate, but you more participate in the way I'm not good at. Like how Holland, when Holland was here, our dear brother that helped direct putting stuff on the trailer, Holland had this such a sweet way of just saying, could you pick that up, put that over there? You know, I never learned that. I learned like lead by example, pick it up myself, and hey, you grab one, I'll grab one, you know. But he could like do the part what you're supposed to do. Now, if you were a priest, okay, you were not supposed to do what I do. You're supposed to stop lifting and start saying, hey, you know, and show the young guys how to do it. And for 15 years, you're supposed to pass on knowledge. It's a mentorship. Okay, that's a beautiful thing, I think. I wish we'd, you know, keep that. By the way, you ever wonder why we have our retirement age 65? Set in, you know, when you get your Social Security, it's from the Levitical law. Our country did adopt some of the things of the Bible right into the practices, but we don't always do that. At 50, you stop doing the heavy work and you start doing the mentoring. Now, some guys that are very wise do this mentoring. In their older years, you'll see they'll step away. But at 65, what happens? You stop doing priestly service. So you want me to tell you at least how young he was? At max, he was not 65, but he was close. He could have been 64 and a half. Could have been his last time to get picked to go into the temple, and he's going to go do the priestly service. Now, the priestly duties, you know, were things like go in and set the table of showbread up. It was the 12 loaves of bread the Lord ordained, one for each of the tribes. They would bake them daily and put them before the Lord. They had the menorah with the candlestick. They would have to put the oil. And so he gets chosen. By the way, this is a big honor to get, because there's so many of the Jews and so many in the tribe of Levi that get the privilege to be chosen. But it was so many guys that, you know, you were lucky if you were drawn by the lot system, the lottery system, we would call it, to get to go do it. So just the fact that this old guy and his wife, who was also advanced in years, are old enough that it says she's barren. She can't have child. And he gets drawn to go in and do the priestly service. This is kind of a big deal. So he goes in before the Lord, it says in verse 8, and it happened while he was performing his priestly service before God in the appointed order of his division. It says, according to the customs of the priestly office, that he was chosen by lot to enter the temple of the Lord to burn the incense. So he got the incense detail. Not the bread, just the incense, okay? And by the way, the incense represented what? Do you guys know this part? No? The prayers that would ascend to God. This was to be a sweet-smelling savor or smell, you know, fragrant aroma to the Lord. Just a continual burning of incense to say, like prayers continually ascending to God. So he gets a kind of cool detail. You know, what's your detail today? I get to go take care of like the, you know, the prayer hotline. I'm trying to paraphrase in today's, like for the kids, okay? They'll get this better if I put it like this. So if you're going in and that's your job and you're older and, you know, this might be one of your last times to ever, it might be one of his only times in his old age to get to go in, and he gets to man the hotline. The prayer hotline. This is, I'm just giving you the concept, okay? So he goes in to burn the incense before the Lord. And listen to this. The whole multitude of the people were in prayer outside. And it was the hour of the incense offering. It's a whole hour of prayer time. With all the people praying, he gets the privilege to go in and light the incense. Like, God, receive our prayers. It's a real cool, like, I mean, you talk about a cool, awesome detail. I got to be an altar boy when I was younger. We thought that was really cool when we got to hand the priest the little chalice with the host in it, those little wafers. And he had one big one on the top. You know, I always drool. I want the big one. You know, coveting bad altar boy. I'm like, handed it to him. The little ones are so small. How come he gets a big one, you know? He's a fat guy. He doesn't need it. I'll eat it. You know, I had all sorts of things going through the mind of a child. But he gets to go in and give the prayer offering to the Lord while all the people for that hour are outside praying. Now, you talk about, like, cool assignment from God. By the way, the Bible tells us in Proverbs, the lot is cast into the lap of men. You know, when you throw the roll of the dice or you draw the straw, it's something we cast in the lap of man, but it says, but it's every decision is from who? From the Lord. The Lord decides who gets what. So the Lord is setting him up for a special day. Zacharias, you get to go bring the prayers before me. Now listen to this. As he's in there, verse 11, here we get to meet Gabriel. An angel of the Lord appeared to him standing to the right of the incense altar. He goes in to do his job, and an angel shows up. You talk about a nice morning, you know. How's your day today, Zacharias? And it says, and notice, just pay attention, I just got to point this out. And Zacharias was troubled when he saw the angel, and fear gripped him. Okay, just so you know, it wasn't a cute little precious moments angel. It was a real one. Because he's going, but the angel said to him, you guys know what he's going to say. Do not be afraid. Fear not, Zacharias. He says, for your petition has been heard. Your prayer has been. Now, how many of us want to hear that from an angel, that God has heard our prayer? I mean, you know, we pray all the time, right? And yeah, sometimes we pray when we're in trouble. God, get us out of this. God, I promise if you get me out of this, I'll never do it again. Or, you know, we make deals in our prayer times. But sometimes we pray, and have any of you ever, and I, not to make it seem like we're unspiritual or anything, but have any of you ever prayed and felt like you're just talking to the air? You're like, not sure, God, are you really hearing me? Like, I really would like to know if you're, I mean, intellectually, in your brain, you might know, but your heart might be going, I'm not so sure. I kind of feel like nobody's home, or if he's home, he ain't answering, or there's this feeling like you're just talking to the, and you just wish an angel would show up and say, God heard your prayer. Don't worry. Let me tell you what he's going to do. You know, wouldn't that be a nice, like, pat on the back, like, prayer's working. You know, I'd be kind of like, hey, guys, let me tell you, I was praying the other day, and an angel showed up. I mean, I was freaked out, but still, it was good. You know, it would be good because it would be that confirmation that the Lord really did hear my prayer. And, I mean, face it, he's the guy going in to give the incense offering, the prayers to the Lord for everyone. And the angel is standing right next to the altar and says to him, can you imagine this? To the old guy, your prayers have been heard. God has heard you. And he's like, oh, and don't be afraid. Wait, I said that first. Don't be afraid. Your prayers have been heard. Wow, what a cool thing. And it says, and listen to this, and he tells him now what God is going to do to answer his prayer. This part I love. He says, and your wife, Elizabeth, will bear you a son, and you will give him the name John. John, that's the masculine form of Jan. I know this because my wife's name is Jan, Janet. John in Hebrew is God's gracious gift. It's the same for, by the way, the feminine of that, Janet or Jan. If any of you, I got a Jan over here, my wife Jan. That's two God's gracious gifts in one service, doubled up. Any Johns while we're here? See, we got the men and the women. God's gracious gift. This is what God, he's going to give him a son, and he's telling him, you're going to name him God's gracious gift. This is the name, what it translates to. I'll tell you the translation of Jesus' name in just a minute, but for right now, I want you to hear this part. Your prayer's been heard, and you're going to have a boy, and you're going to name him John. and you will have joy and gladness, and many will rejoice at his birth. And so it says, and the angel told him, verse 15, for he will be great in the sight of the Lord. And he will not drink, he'll drink no wine or liquor, for he will be filled with the Holy Spirit while yet in his mother's womb. I find this really interesting because the scripture that says, don't be drunk with wine, but instead be filled with the Holy Spirit. The true best high you could ever get is not from a bottle. It's not drinking alcohol to give you the buzz. The best high you can get is being buzzed on the Holy Ghost, because there's no hangover. Okay, I mean, you get all the good stuff with it and no bad stuff. There's no drawback, right? And you can't be pulled over and arrested for blowing too high of a number on the little breathalyzer. Because you don't, it gives you the boost, but from the way it's really meant to be, in your spirit. You know, that's why, do you remember Prohibition days? They used to say liquor was called what? In the bottle. Spirits. It opened you up to, not to the Holy Spirit, to other demonic spirits that it seems to. I've heard some horrible revelations from people that when they start getting a little too sauced, and they all of a sudden it's like they just direct line to the pit, you know, and the devil's just whispering in their ear and it just keeps coming out of them. It's because they filled themselves with the wrong spirit. But this says that Zacharias is hearing this from the angel. You're going to have a son and he's never going to drink. He won't drink alcohol. Instead, he'll be filled with the Holy Spirit. Well, we're talking from the early days. While he's still in the mother's womb, he'll be filled with the Holy Spirit. Well, then the angel told him, and he will turn back the sons of Israel back to the Lord their God. Now, I want you to pay attention to this. Do you think the children of Israel always followed the Lord? They were always such good God-fearing people, right? What do we read about them in the Bible? It tattles on them all the time. I mean, they do evil, and the Lord sends a prophet to say, knock off the evil or you're going to get punished. And if you do what's right, you'll be blessed. And do they always knock off the evil? No. Sometimes they got to go get carried away into captivity. And then after a long punishment, sometimes the light goes on. They wake up. Lord, we're sorry. And then, of course, what's our gracious God do? Forgives them, delivers them, brings them back. Well, this is kind of cool. You're a priest, and you're being told you're going to have a boy, and your boy is going to turn the hearts of the people back to the Lord. Do you think he knew as a priest that the heart of the people wasn't really towards the Lord? I mean, if he'd been doing this a while, he's an old guy. He's been doing the priestly service for a while. He's probably got his finger on the pulse. He probably knows. Yeah, they really ain't really into serving God. That's kind of cool. My boy? I mean, dads always want something great for their boy. Your son is going to be great in the sight of the Lord. He's going to turn back the people to the Lord, their hearts. And it is he, verse 17, who will go as a forerunner before him in the spirit and the power of Elijah, to turn back the hearts of the fathers back to the children and the disobedient to the attitude of righteousness, so as to make ready a people prepared for the Lord. He's going to be the forerunner to the Messiah, the guy who says, get ready for the Lord. You know, prepare your heart. Prepare ye the way of the Lord. The Lord's coming. Now, that's a pretty big billing to be booked on. But who said he's going to do this? The angel Gabriel. And listen to Zacharias. Zacharias said to the angel, now you're in the temple, you're giving the offering for the prayers, and the angel's telling you what God's heard your prayer and he's giving you the answer right on the spot. And let me show you how good guys are at receiving angelic messages. I'm going to contrast this with how good girls are in just a minute, okay? Because you're going to see a difference in this story. Those of you guys already know the part when Mary gets to visit, you'll see. Listen to the attitude of this man, the older spiritual priest. How do I know for certain this is going to happen? I read it like that, but I think it's probably pretty accurate. Because he says, "For I am an old man, and my wife is advanced in years." And the angel answered him and said, "I am Gabriel, who stands in the presence of God, and I have been sent to speak to you to bring you this good news." Now, if you don't know Hebrew, it's okay, but Gabriel in Hebrew, Gab, what we get for the first part of Gabriel's name, Gab, is what we use to get the word over to English. Gab means to what? To talk or to speak. And Gabriel is the one who speaks. Re for, and El is for Elohim, the one who speaks for God. For God, I am the one who's, in other words, like the mouthpiece, just sent to speak on behalf. You know, everyone wants God to tell them something. I show up, I'm here to tell you. My name is the one who speaks for God. Like you know, you wanted an answer. Now you get the answer, and now you're telling me, how do I know? Dude, I'm the one sent. I stand in God's presence. I came to tell you. I told you. And because, now listen to this. Some of you know this part of the story, but I think it's awesome. It's even more awesome when you know Gabriel, who speaks for God, says, "I got a judgment for you, bucko. Because you don't believe. Behold, you shall be silent and unable to speak until the day that this comes to pass, because you did not believe my words, which will be fulfilled in their proper time." The guy who speaks for God, "Let me pick a punishment for you, buddy. You're not going to be able to speak." Now, I don't know if you find this humorous like I do, but I think it's funny. Because I read ahead. It says in verse 21, the people were waiting for Zacharias, and they were wondering at his delay in the temple. But when he came out, look at this, verse 22 says, when he came out, he was unable to speak to them. And they realized he had seen a vision in the temple. And he kept making signs to them, and he remained mute. He couldn't talk. Now, when the days of his priestly service were ended, he went back home. And after these days, Elizabeth, his wife, became pregnant. She liked the strong, silent type, obviously. And she kept herself in seclusion for 5 months, saying, "This is the way the Lord has dealt with me in the days when he looked with favor upon me to take away my disgrace among men." God, now her heart was, "God, thank you. You've given me a child." It was a disgrace to her to feel like I can't have a child. And it was like the Lord lifted that from her. Now, in the sixth month of her pregnancy, verse 26 is where we're going to get another visit from Gabriel, but to a different person. In the sixth month, it says, the angel Gabriel was sent from God to a city in Galilee called Nazareth. Now, you guys are going to know this part because this part gets read all the time in Christmas services. To a virgin engaged to a man whose name was Joseph, the descendant of David. And the virgin's name was Marie. No, Mary. It's Italian for me. But she was very perplexed. He came in, he said, "Greetings, favored one. The Lord is with you." And it says she was very perplexed at this statement. And she kept pondering what kind of salutation this was. What? The Lord is with me. What? And the angel said to her, you got it, Mike. "Do not be afraid. For you have found favor with God. And behold, you will conceive. And in your womb," it says, "and you will bear a son. And you will name him Jesus." Now that's the English for the Hebrew Yahshua or Jehovah Shua is actually what it says in the Hebrew right here. That you name him Jehovah Shua, or the contraction is Yahshua. Which Jehovah is the name of the Lord. Shua is salvation. So Jesus's name translated, you go up to him in school, "Hey, what's your name?" "The Lord's salvation." "Well, it's kind of cryptic, man." "What, are you sure?" "Yeah, I'm pretty sure. Angel gave it to me before I even got here. Mom told me all about it. Freaked her out, but she went with it, and she told her some other stuff too. And it says, and he will be great, and he will be called the Son of the Most High, and the Lord God will give him the throne of his father David, and he will reign over the house of Jacob forever, and his kingdom will have no end. And Mary said to the angel, how can this be, since I'm a virgin? Now, she wasn't saying, I don't believe it can happen, but she just was asking a question, like, particulars, like, I've never been with anybody, so I can't be with child. I mean, there's like, you know, they grew up on farms. They knew how the birds and the bees and all that stuff worked. And she's like, I haven't had any relation with anyone. I'm a virgin. How can I have a child? And the angel, now, just to show you that she wasn't going like, Zacharias, how can this be? I don't, you know, believe you. She's more asking the question of just like, how? Not, but not like with disbelief. I can tell she has a different attitude because you guys know how she answers, right? The angel says to her, well, the Holy Spirit will come upon you and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. For this reason, the Holy Child shall be called the Son of God. You're not going to have relations with a man. God, who created us, is going to have his Spirit impregnate you. His Spirit will cause you to be with child. Now this, it says, and then the angel told her, and behold, even your relative Elizabeth has also conceived a son in her old age. And she who is called barren is now in her sixth month. So Mary gets the news that Elizabeth is with child, not from the grapevine, but from the direct heavenly intercom. God sends the angel to tell her. Listen to this. It says, and the angel said, for nothing will be impossible with God. And Mary said, behold, the bondslave of the Lord, may it be done to me according to your word. And the angel departed. So she didn't go, I don't believe you. She went, you say so, I got it. Okay. Now, at this time, I love what she does next. You guys know this, right? At this time, Mary arose in a hurry and went to the hill country, to the city of Judah, and entered the house of Zacharias and greeted Elizabeth. Well, she just found out from the angel that Elizabeth's with child. And she's going to have one, too. So what'd she do? She boogies over to see. Let me go run up there and see. And it says, as soon as... this, I like this part. When Elizabeth heard Mary's greeting, the baby leaped in her womb, and Elizabeth was filled with the Holy Spirit. Right? That, you remember how it said, the angel said, the child will be filled with the Spirit while still in the mother's womb? When did it happen? When Mary's voice greeted Elizabeth. Hey, Elizabeth, it's Mary. All of a sudden, the Holy Spirit fills her to full. I mean, her son is inside. He's filled with the Holy Ghost inside his mom, and she cries out with a loud voice and says, blessed are you among women, and blessed is the fruit of your womb. And how has it happened to me that the mother of my Lord would come to me? For behold, when the sound of your greeting reached my ears, Elizabeth said, the baby leaped in my womb for joy, and blessed is she who believed that there would be a fulfillment of what had been spoken to her by the Lord. Blessed are you, Mary, because you believe. Now, it's funny how the lady's reaction is so much different than the guy's. God says he's going to do this, no problem. They go with it. The guys are like, I don't know, how are you going to do that? But the ladies are like, hey, he said it, man. He's God. He's, you know, like, and the angel said it. You know, there's nothing that is by the way, if you have an understanding that there is something that God can't do, you know, there's something impossible for God, you got a really small God. The guy I serve, I go with what Gabriel said. I think Gabriel's got it right. There is nothing that is impossible with God. That's the God I serve. Same for you? Yeah? Amen? So the women, they got it. And Mary, this is called the Magnificat in my Bible. It's a little title above this paragraph. It's going to be a praise, a magnifying of the Lord, where Mary's just going to spontaneously praise the Lord. Now, this part we had to learn in Catholic school. This was part of the catechism we had to learn. What did Mary say when she greeted Elizabeth, you know, when Elizabeth said, you're blessed because you believe what God said, and you're going to be the mother of my Lord. In other words, I'm just going to be bringing up the forerunner to the Christ. You're going to be bringing up the Messiah. Now, how does Elizabeth know this? She's got Zacharias. He can't talk yet. But she had the Holy Spirit, yeah. And she knows. By the Spirit of God, she knows. You know, some of the things we know by the Spirit of God, some of them are like, oh, I don't get it. I have to tell them, have you received God's Spirit yet? Because without His Spirit, this whole thing's a mystery. As soon as you have His Spirit, it's like the veil is lifted off. It's just like, whoa, I see it. This is super cool. And listen to this. Mary then cries out, my soul exults. Exult means exceedingly leaps for joy in the Lord. And my spirit has rejoiced in God my Savior, for He has had regard for the humble state of His bondservant. And behold, from this time on, all generations will count me blessed. This is the first line I had to learn in Catholic school about Mary, that from that time on, all generations would count her blessed. Why? Because she was humble, and God said, you know, the Bible says God's opposed to the proud, but He gives grace to the humble. And this woman had a humility that God said, I see her humility and her faith, and I'm going to bless her. And she's going to bear the Messiah. Now, that's a pretty big... This was the dream of all the Jewish gals, that someday, because they had the promise from the beginning that the Messiah would come, remember, from Abraham, through Isaac, to Jacob, always repeated the promise over and over and over, and they're just waiting. Somebody gets to have the privilege. But it was this humble girl, Mary. And she said, for the Mighty One has done great things for me, and holy is His name. And His mercy is upon generation after generation towards those who fear Him. By the way, she's just quoting the Psalms right there. Psalm 103, verse 17, that's a quote. And she said, and He has done mighty deeds with His arm. He scattered those who were proud in thoughts of their heart. And He brought down rulers from their thrones. He exalted those who were humble. And He has filled the hungry with good things. He's sent away the rich empty-handed. This is contrast of how the Lord does deal with different people, isn't it? But Mary recognizes it. She says, and He has given help to Israel, His servant, in remembrance of His mercy. And He spoke, as He spoke to our fathers, to Abraham and to his descendants forever. And Mary stayed with Elizabeth about 3 months, and then she returned home. So if she stays about 3 months, how far along is Elizabeth in her pregnancy? 9 months, right? Full term. Well, look at verse 57. Now at this time, Elizabeth, the time came for her to give birth. She gave birth to a son. And her neighbors and her relatives heard the Lord had displayed His great mercy towards her, and they were rejoicing with Elizabeth. And it happened on the eighth day. The day when it came time to circumcise the child. Remember, if you have a boy, on the eighth day you circumcise him, and that's the official day what you name the child. Okay, for girls, it's longer. They get 40 days, okay, before this ceremony takes place. But with the boys, it's on the eighth day. So, by the way, just a quick like side note, on the eighth day of our whole immune system, there was a study done on the human body, that on the eighth day since we were born, the immune system is at the highest it will be in its entire lifespan. So God picks what day to circumcise them? I mean, this before modern medicine, He already knew. It's like, oh, I'll just put it down, eighth day, circumcise them on that day. You know, quick healing. You got it built into the immune system. So they go to circumcise the little baby boy. And it says, and they came, you know, it says, to the father, and they were going to call him Zacharias after the dad. But his mother answered and said, no, indeed he shall be called John. How did she know that? How did Elizabeth know? Dad must have somehow written something, a note, honey, we're not calling him Zacharias after me. We're calling him John. And they said to her, there's no one amongst your relatives who's got that name. That's not the tradition. You got to carry on the name. And she goes, nope. So they made signs to the father. What do you want to call him? And he asked for a tablet, and he wrote, his name is John. And it says they were all astonished. And at once, his mouth was opened, his tongue was loosed, and he began to speak praise to God. And fear came on all those that were living in the area around them, going, I wonder what's going on. I mean, it says, and they were talking about all the matters of this, you know, in the hill countries of Judea. And all who heard were wondering. They kept in mind saying, what will this child turn out to be? For the hand of the Lord is certainly with him. Dad hasn't been able to talk for over 9 months. And on the day we're going to name the baby, Mom says John, and he writes on the tablet John. And as soon as he writes, his name is John. By the way, who's he agreeing with finally? Gabriel. Because Gabriel did tell him, you're going to name him God's gracious gift, John. And then it says his father Zacharias was filled with the Holy Spirit. Oh, now he joins Mom. A little late, but better late than never. He gets filled with the Holy Spirit, and he prophesies, saying, blessed be the Lord God of Israel, for he has visited and accomplished redemption for his people, and he has raised up a horn of salvation for us in the house of David, his servant, as he spoke by the mouth of his holy prophets of old, salvation from our enemies and from the hand of all who hate us, to show mercy towards our fathers and to remember his holy covenant. God made this covenant a long time ago with us. He's fulfilling it. He says, and the oath which he swore to Abraham, our father, to grant us that we, being rescued from the hand of our enemies, might serve him without fear, in holiness and righteousness before him all our days. And you, child, will be called the prophet of the Most High. For you will go on before the Lord to prepare his ways, to give his people the knowledge of salvation by the forgiveness of their sins. He says, because of the tender mercy of our God. Isn't it sweet? God's salvation is granted to us by forgiveness of our sins. And it's because, it says, of the tender mercy of God. Sometimes God gets a bad rap. You know, like the meanie biskini in the sky, that bad guy is always going to zap us. And when I read about him in the scripture, it says he's a God of tender mercy. What's this? What does it say in Lamentations? His mercy is new every what? Every morning. And great is his faithfulness. He's such a merciful God. And he causes, it says, the sunrise on high to visit us. Sunrise on high. I wonder who he's talking about. Now, this says S-U-N in my Bible, not S-O-N. But it is God's sun to shine upon those who sit in darkness and the shadow of death, to guide our feet into the way of peace. He quotes Isaiah chapter 9, the passage about the Messiah. Just coincidence, right? He just threw this in that you'll cause to shine upon us that sunrise of the Messiah. He says, and the child then continued to grow and become strong, John did, in spirit, and he lived in the desert until the day of his public appearance to Israel. Now we come to chapter 2. Luke writes long chapters. I'm so sorry. I should be done with the sermon by now. It's Luke's fault, okay? But he teaches me something that I can't point out the part about Jesus here until I give you the part about Mary and Elizabeth. Because look at this. In the days, now this is the part you guys probably had to read. I'm just going to buzz through. I'm going to read you as quick as I can so that you can hear the part of the birth of our Lord. Okay, we got the birth of John. He's how much older than Jesus? 6 months. So now it says in chapter 2, verse 1, in the days, it says, in those days a decree went out from Caesar Augustus that a census be taken of all the inhabited earth. This was the first census taken while Quirinius was governor of Syria, and everyone was on his way to register for the census, each to his own city. Now Joseph also went up from Galilee, from the city of Nazareth, to Judea, to the city of David, which is called Bethlehem. House Bethlehem, what? Bread. House of bread. And who's going to be born at the house of bread? The bread of life, Jesus. That's another cryptic, hidden message, right? The bread of life come down from heaven is born at the place called the house of bread. Anyway, because he was of the house of the family of David, in order to register along with Mary, who was engaged to him and was with child. Now, while they were there, the days for Mary were completed for her to give birth. We just jumped to Mary's full term, 9 months, time for her to give birth. So she gave birth to her firstborn son. She wrapped him in cloth, laid him what? In a manger, because there was no room for them in the inn. You guys all have heard this story. In the same region, there were some shepherds. They were in the field keeping watch over their flocks by night. And an angel of the Lord, one angel, when we sing, the first Noel, the angel did say, not the angels, the angel, one angel stood before these shepherds, and it says, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were terribly, afraid, frightened. Yeah. But the angel said to them, this is another real account, do not be afraid. For behold, I bring you good news of great joy, which shall be for all the people. For today in the city of David there has been born for you a Savior, who is Christ the Lord. And this will be a sign for you. You will find a baby wrapped in cloth, lying in a manger. That's where we put all the newborns, right? In a manger. A manger is a feeding trough for animals. I could have never gotten away with putting my baby. I got away with putting our baby in a suitcase when we were coming home from Kapi'olani on another island because we didn't have a crib. So we took one of our suitcases and we opened it and we made it like a little baby bassinet. But if I would have said to my wife, on the firstborn child, maybe by the fourth one we could have got away with it with Raquel, but you know how moms are like protective mama bears when it comes to the firstborn? This is Mary's first child. And does she know it's the Son of God? No matter what anyone else says, she knows, no hanky-panky with anybody. She has a child from God. Is she going to be happy about putting him in cloth and putting him in a feeding trough for an animal? I mean, I'd be like, this is one of my things. I know that God shows me how humble it says he humbled himself to the form of a man. But he didn't just humble himself to the form of a man. Even his entrance to this world, I can't even be jealous of. I was God, and I was sending my son to save a bunch of Cretans. I'd be like, build him a wing. No, build him a whole hospital. Mary, you get to go to your own hospital. You're the first patient, And it would be pristine. And there were going to be an incubator with a warming tray and the whole lights and everything. No, born in the little, no room in the inn, stick them out in the barn, put them in a trough. But this is how Jesus came to this world. And this was the sign. Now, who's the angel talking to? Who'd he go visit? Shepherds. I don't know how to tell you this. When we went to Israel and we were passing over the backside of the Mount of Olives towards the valley, what's called the Valley of the Thieves or the Valley of the Shadow of Death, it's referred to in the Psalm. Psalm 23, yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I fear no evil, for thou art with me. That's an actual valley that goes from the backside of the Mount of Olives towards Jericho. It's a deep ravine. And we were on one of our early trips to Israel many years ago, many decades. Oh gosh, I don't want to tell you this. Okay, it was a long time ago. I was really young, and I didn't always stay on the path, okay, that the guide wanted us to. So I was running around checking out stuff in the hills, and he's going, "Be careful because there's shepherds here." And we're like, "So shepherds? Yeah, they're in the Bible. They take care of the sheep." He says, shepherds here, you don't understand. They have a reputation. They had this reputation since the days of the Bible. They're vagrant wanderers. They move the flock where they need to go. And since they're just passing through lots of places, they were known for having stinky fingers, yeah. And so he's telling me, be careful, because if they find you over the side of the hill here, they'll roll you and take everything, and then, you know, it'll be the story of the Good Samaritan all over. Well, you'll be the one laying on the road. And she's telling me this, and I'm thinking, wait a minute, Jesus, you send an angel. The first Noel, the angel did say, was there certain poor, didn't it say poor shepherds? Poor shepherds, sticky fingers. Hey, you guys, the Messiah's been born. There's going to be a sign. He's going to be wrapped in cloth, lying in a, you know, feeding trough. Go check it out. Oh, yeah, but don't be afraid. I mean, he did say that, right? And then suddenly, just to, like, throw a little accent onto the whole scene, suddenly there appeared, and with the angel, a multitude of heavenly hosts. This is where, ta-da, pull back the curtain a little farther, and then all the angels of heaven that have been waiting to sing this song, just, I mean, they've been tuning up, practicing for the announcing of the Messiah. I can just see it from their side, you know, the curtain. The curtain pulls back. They're like, the audience is there. Where are they? Wait a minute, it's kind of dim out there. You got some poor shepherds. This is a bunch of little white dots. What is that? Oh, them sheep. We're going to sing to the shepherds and some sheep? Glory to God in the highest, on earth peace among men, with whom he's well pleased. And then the angels, when they had gone away from them into heaven, it says the shepherds began to say to one another, you know, maybe we should go check this out. No, I'm paraphrasing. They said, let us go straight away to Bethlehem and see this thing which the Lord has made known to us. So they came in a hurry. They found the way to Mary and Joseph and the baby as he lay where? In the manger. Angels got it right. When they saw this, they made known the statement which had been told to them about the child. And all who heard it wondered at these things which were told to them by the shepherd. But Mary, it says she treasured all these things, pondering them in her heart. And the shepherds went back, glorifying and praising God for all they had heard and seen, just as it had been told them. They were jazzed, man. We had angels visit. And, you know, here it goes back to the guy thing again, but do they believe it right away? No, let's go check it out. Then they check it out, and it's for real. Because they're probably thinking, who wraps a baby and puts him in a feeding trough? We're shepherds. We know better than that. You know, that's where we have to stay, out in the barn. You don't put babies there. And then they get there. There's a baby there. Hey, maybe this is right. Those angels were kind of freaky. Hey, lady, by the way, we just had some angels show you that glory to God in the highest and peace. And it was a pretty good song. And they tell Mary. And what's Mary do? It says she treasured all these things in her heart. She believed it. They went away going, wow, it really was true. And when 8 days were passed for Jesus to be circumcised, they circumcised him and they called his name Jehovah Shua, Yahshua, or Jesus in English, the name given to him by the angel before he was conceived in the womb. Now you can read the rest of the chapter. It's Luke, he's long-winded. But it's a good chapter. You know, you get to see the rest of him, you know, the part where I like the next part where he goes to the temple and they bring the baby in, and Simeon, the old guy, he says, all right, Lord, you can take me now. My eyes have seen the fulfillment of your promise. You said, I won't die till I see the coming of the Messiah. And as soon as he sees Mary and Joseph bringing the baby in for the, you know, what we call a baby dedication, when they did the circumcision and named the boy, he's like, take me, Lord. I've seen you answer your, you promised, you said I wouldn't die till I saw it. I see it. And, oh, by the way, what does Mary do with all these things again? treasures them up in her heart. There's a lady, a widow, that was with her husband, what, 7-8 years? And then all the way from the time after he died, she stayed in the temple to her old age. And it says, to the age of 84, she never left the temple, serving night and day with fasting and prayers. And as soon as she sees the baby Jesus, at that very moment, verse 38 says, she came up and began giving thanks to God, and she continued to speak to him, of him, to all of those that were looking for the redemption of Jerusalem. Anyone looking for the guy who's going to redeem us, you know, out of our sin? The Redeemer that's been promised? Anyone? Here's old Mary holding the baby going, it's my boy. And what's she do at the end of the chapter? Treasure up all these things in her heart. I mean, by the way, I think baby dedications are more for the mom and the dad than the baby. The baby's too young. They don't remember none of it. But ask mom or dad. Especially mom. Mom went, God, you gave me this child. And I just had some shepherds show up, and they didn't steal anything. They just said, you visited. And you sent the Messiah. Oh, treasure that up. Because she already heard that from the angel. But sometimes, even when we hear something from an angel, isn't it good to hear like a, what we call confirmation? Like someone else comes along and goes, man, that's really cool. That's the Lord, man. He has done that for you for sure. You know, it's something good about, it's just our faith. Our faith needs a little boost. And if you don't think our faith needs a boost, why do we got to go to church every week? A little boost, right? I mean, if this was a one and done thing, I could just preach this once, you'd be done, you got it. Faith good, golden forever, right? Go on strong, right? It doesn't work that way. The Bible says faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. We just need to hear. And we need it, you know, the Bible says taste and see that the Lord is good. I like that it puts it that way. It brings it to something I'm very familiar with, eating. You know, like the Lord just says, you want to know if I'm really real? Try it. Take a taste of me and see if I'm not good. Try me out. You know, the thing is, once you taste of the Lord, you're spoiled for anything else. Because once you had a good taste of His grace and His mercy, you're like, who wants anything? I mean, the rest is all imitation. It's like, it's no good. You know, you got to go back for more. You know, I know we're going to dismiss now and go off to have family Christmas dinners and stuff. And some of you are getting ready to go all out on the spread. I'm allowed to talk about this at the end of the sermon because I can't do it in the middle or I die. If you start talking about food, like Christmas food in Italian family, what we have, a lot of special dishes, what we only make once a year. You know, we make a thing called pinolada. It's a really pain in the backside to make, but it's really good. It's a homemade dough. What you roll the dough, it's like a kind of like a pastry dough, like of a donut. But you roll it into little pieces with your hand until it's like thin, like your finger, like this. And then you cut them into little teeny cubes with a knife. And then you deep fry them, like you're frying a donut, but they're all little baby golden brown donuts. And then you put them into the pan, and you put honey, and you put you chop up chocolate bar, and you put little candies, and you mix it all together. And then you pour, well, Nona pours it, because you're not allowed to when you're the kid. They pour a little bit of, like, some kind of alcohol, like of rum or something that, I don't even know what it is, because my Nona did all the time. They cover it with this thing, and then they cover with cloth. And they make, oh, by the way, you make this a month ahead of time. And you store it in the thing so that the flavors all, somehow the juices and all the stuff comes together. And it kind of like presses into this. And you have to cut or tear off a piece of it. It's like this glob of goodness. It's just, it's hard to explain. But it's a lot of work, okay? And it's not you do this any day. It's just like you only do this once a year, special times. And then they make, you know, gnocchi, which is like a homemade pasta with the thumb, and you make bignolata, you make, never mind, I'm getting too hungry again. But see, you get the idea. You make these certain foods. How many of you have a special, like, food what you think of when it's holiday time? Like your grandmother made, or your mother made, or you make the special thing, yeah? When you taste of those things, it's funny how we're wired. You just have to taste of it. And then once you taste it, you're like, oh, that's good. And by the way, you know it's impossible to crave anything you've never tasted. See, you probably can't crave piñalada like I can, because you never had it. But if you had it, you had a good one. Or a good cannoli. You know, with the nice rich cream and the chocolate shavings in there and a little powdered sugar on the top. And the crust is just perfect, flaky. You have a really good cannoli. You know. Oh, all I got to do is think about it. And my mouth is already getting juices. It's going, mmm. And why does it do that? Because I've tasted of it. I've seen that it's good. And when someone says to me, I don't know if God's good, I said, you never tasted. That's all I can tell them. It's kind of like saying, I don't think a cannoli's good. You never tried one. You never had one of my family's one. I can tell you that already. Because Farina, my godmother, my aunt, she made the cannoli with a different kind of filling than my grandmother. They had two different kinds. Oh, we could tell you who made what just looking. Cause one was done with a kind of a cottage cheese or fresh, and the other one was done with the cream, the sweet cream, and you'd be like, oh wow, they're both so good. I want both. Because if you had both, you didn't want one or the other. You want one of each. And a piñalada. And you just fill the plate with some of everything, and you're like, oh, this is holiday. But see, I want you to have a good spiritual holiday and understand the Lord is good. But you need to just taste of his mercy. And God always gives grace to the humble, like Mary, like Elizabeth. So don't, if you can receive this, let's don't be prideful this time of year. Let's be humble people. Let's just be thankful. We have what we have because of the grace of God. Some people are judgmental of others. They're like, well, that person doesn't have it because they're just messed up. Yeah. You know what? We all mess up. Let's be humble about it. I mean, haven't we all not messed up at some point? Thank God there's a God of mercy that is merciful every day. And that's something, that's not just something I need to taste and hear of just once. It's like this is like what you call real soul food. I need to taste and hear about his mercy, like just like I need to eat every day. I need food to keep this body going physically. I need food for my spirit to keep my spirit going. And so that's why we keep going to church. That's why we keep going and saying, God, feed my soul. Let me hear these things to give my soul that, you know, Jesus has come to me, all ye are weary, heavy laden, I'll give you rest. Come, all ye who are thirsty, he says, I'll give you to drink. That living water to satisfy. Come, all ye who are hungry, come, I'll give you of this living bread. What bread was he talking about? Remember Jesus? He said, this is my body broken for you. This is the true bread of life come down from heaven. Here. Here's a living bread born at what house? Bethlehem, the house of bread. Don't forget that part. If you don't remember anything else from the sermon, where was the bread of life born? In the house of bread. It's cryptic. Except if you know Hebrew, you're like, that ain't cryptic. That's so obvious. That's in your face. Like, in your face. Bread of life born, house of bread. Thank you, Lord, for that bread. May you just taste of it this holiday season, and may you just let it come and satisfy your soul. Jesus wants to satisfy. This is all we got to do. Taste. Take a taste. It's good, isn't it? Once you have a good taste, you'll be back. Be like, oh, that was good. It's funny how you can eat one cannoli. And then you go a couple hours and you can have another one. Right? Does this happen on holidays? Why does the whole pumpkin pie go away at Thanksgiving? Why does the whole pecan pie go? Bye-bye. But we had one taste earlier. Wasn't that enough? No. Got to come back a little smidge. I'll just have a little bit later. I just have another little bite. That's all we need to do for our faith this year. A little nibble, little bite, little more. Feed your soul. It's good for you. Strengthens you inside. Let's pray. Lord God, I just thank you for every person here. The privilege we have to gather on a beach in Hawaii. We're so grateful. Thanks for the beautiful day you've given us. The breeze, Lord. The wonderful wallpaper. If it's all right, Lord, as we end in prayer and carry off things to pack them away, Lord, ask if it'd be all right. You'd send a few whales to come and hear some of the praise music as we go on with our day. We thank you, Lord, for the gift that you've given of your Son. Thank you, Jesus, being God's salvation, Jehovah Shua, Yahshua, our Savior. Thanks for that great news. And help us have faith like Mary did and Elizabeth, Lord, that would just believe what you say. I don't want to do the Zacharias maneuver, Lord, and have to have judgment till I finally see it happen, Lord. Just let me believe you, because there is nothing that is impossible with you. May we just carry that from this place in our hearts, Lord. Nothing is impossible with you. We ask this in Jesus' name. And everyone that agreed with me said? Amen. Amen. I hope that you really do have that attitude that the angel was, you know, telling him. There's nothing impossible with God. Just if you really want to have a good week in your faith, you start coming up against things, you kind of struggle and going, I don't know. Just be reminded of this part of the sermon. There's not what the angel said. Nothing is impossible with God.
Mahalo for joining us. If you'd like more information about us, go to our website, AmazingGraceKona.com, and click the link to follow us on Facebook. That's AmazingGraceKona.com. Mahalo, and God bless.